This interview is made possible by the View Conference, the biggest computer graphics conference in Italy. Our dates for 2023 are from the 15th to the 20th of October. We hope to see you in Italy or online. For more information about View Conference, please visit our website, viewconference.it. Guillermo and Mark, I want to say massive congratulations on your Oscar nomination. Congratulations for winning the Golden Globe. Pinocchio is up also for 3 BAFTAs and 9 mm-hmm. Annie Awards, and the list goes on. So can you please tell me what the nomination means to you?
Well, I'm really pleased because for my colleagues, for my family, essentially, who worked on this film for years. I mean, we just poured ourselves into it. And I think we knew we were working on something pretty special early on. So everyone really gave their all on this. So this is just, recognition of the work of so many artists, painters and sculptors and, you know, people who lit and, well, the animators, obviously, but also people like our scheduler. I mean, there's people who don't get the kind of credit they deserve. And a job like this is incredibly complicated, and it requires some pretty unique minds to bring it across the finish line.
You know, every time I you're representing the work of a lot of people, and every time that this connects in a major way with an audience or with a community, everything was worth it. And the other message for the community is you can make films in an independent way, even if it's done by a major company. If you carve that freedom from the beginning, this is not a movie that was tested and rearranged and repaired according to the opinion of a poll group. This was a very, very personal, very, very individual, very artistic movie. And it is successful in reaching an audience. And that has to be used by the community to say, look, in the same way that it has been used in TV, to create more and more independent animated sort of tones. And, you know, we are not looking at the animated TV of 20 years ago. And nevertheless, the movement of progression in more commercial movies is slower. So it's really great. All our artists, every one of them took the challenge and gave their best. And here we are in a really beautiful fashion.
Where does animation fit into the overall craft of filmmaking?
I would say in the case of stop motion, it should be really, really recognized as an analog craft that requires actually another layer of depth and dedication, because you're creating physical sets, physical props. You have real cinematography. You are really moving an actor across time and space, but you're doing it in miniature, 24 frames a second. It's remarkable. And there is production design, there is cinematography, there is, of course, screenplay writing, directing. And I think that is very important for the community to continue the fight to be recognized in other categories as any other of the mediums does, and to keep repeating the message like a mantra. Animation is not a genre for kids. It's a medium. Animation is film, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I think, it's much more analogous to live action than, you know, a lot of animation is. And I think that you could actually even make the argument that there are lots of live action films that have far more visual effects than we do. Yeah. I mean, we're way more analog than a lot of big movies that are just loaded with, you know, with digital effects.
Yes, that's a great point. And I think even Mark has made the point several times. Unlike a live action film, we cannot go and rent props. We cannot rent wardrobe. Everything we have, a spoon that is held in a hand, all the way to every wardrobe of an extra, and the extras, we have to carve them. We cannot go to central casting and get 50 extras. We got to make them. We cannot go and rent a spoon. So it is, I've been using this analogy. I say stop motion is to live action what Ginger Rogers is to Fred Astaire. We have to do the same thing with us, backwards in high heels.
I want to tell you a story. It's a story you may think you know, but you don't.
Over there!
What is that?
Papa!
It speaks!
He's just a puppet!
No, I'm not! I'm a real boy!
People are sometimes afraid of things they don't know.
I don't understand!
Ah! We have found him! Our star!
Everyone shall love you and call your name Pinocchio.
Pinocchio!
I have something I'd like to give you. It is a school book which belonged to a very special boy.
The boy you lost? Papa!
Enough of this nonsense.
Hey, where are you going?
You tell him I love him. And I won't be a burden anymore. Hello?
The wooden boy with the borrowed soul. While you may have eternal life, your loved ones, they do not. You never know how long you have with someone until they're gone.
The boy loves you for who you are.
Guide him to be good.
Stop that! Don't hurt him anymore!
You may have no strength, but I control you. Please bring him back to me.
Papa!
Pinocchio!
Life is such a wonderful gift.
If you ask people about Pinocchio in the street, they probably immediately think about the 1940 Walt Disney film. But of course, the story comes from the Italian writer Carlo Collodi and goes back to 1881 when it first appeared in serial form. Then it was published in book form in 1883. Can you both kindly just walk me through your own Pinocchio journey? When did you read the book first and what did it mean to you?
I think my first exposure to Pinocchio was actually Astro Boy. So I came at the story from that direction. But I think what that shows you is what a universal story it is. And it can be told in so many different ways and it can be just tweaked and could be put in the future, it can be moved around. It has something to say to many, many generations. It's enduring, and I think that's its power.
Collodi, the first time I learned about Pinocchio was through the Disney film, a film that I hold as sacred. It's a landmark in animation for me, and I collect the original art by Gustav Tangren, in his concepts of Pinocchio, and I worship it. But the tale belongs and is malleable for many, many versions. And I think that you can find it on AI, or you can find it on Astro Boy, or you can find it as a metaphor for this or that, family, truth, blah, blah, blah. And Collodi, I read him in my, much later, I think I was in my 20s, and I found the book fascinating and Collodi's life fascinating. I love that he was born and had a very strong sense of class, and he wanted to be a priest. He was a very religious man, and the movie and his book are full of religious symbols. You know, there is an echo of the cross in Pinocchio. There is an echo of Jonah and the whale from the Bible. There is a lot of Christian hermetic symbology. And there is a hermetic reading of Pinocchio, you know, arriving to the shore is a symbol for arriving to the shore of life. There's a few studies of the hermetic significance of Pinocchio. I read them all as a young man, and I just thought, yeah, we can layer the screenplay like that. And we have five levels of storytelling going on the Pinocchio screenplay all at the same time, and having structured more than 30 screenplays, I can tell you this is one of the ones that it was very difficult to solve. We read it loud with the crew and the cast, and we read it loud again and again, and we kept reworking it because it needs a balance that is delicate to achieve.
In adapting the story, what were the essential Pinocchio elements that you wanted to keep? And what were some new ingredients that you wanted to bring to the screen?
The opening line on the film, which was it was very, very planned to open with a hook and very telegraphic, is by the time Master Geppetto made Pinocchio, he had already lost the son. And that's the hook. It tells you what is to come, sort of prepares you, blah, blah, blah. But I think that the elements you keep are the landmarks only. The rest of the song is new, and it has to come from you. It cannot come from any version of Pinocchio. It has to speak of your soul. The landmarks are, he was carved by a carpenter called Geppetto. His nose grows, you know. He's going to go into the whale. He's going to get deviated from the school by a swindler. He's going to be on a puppet show. He's going to reject the puppet show. He's going to blah, blah. Those are the landmarks. The rest is a completely new engine. And I think it's in many ways an anti-Pinocchio, because it says disobedience is a virtue, not obedience. And you don't have to change to be a real boy. It is Geppetto that has to learn to be a real father.
Yeah. Well, I think the last line of the film is also one of my favorites. You know, what happens, happens. And then the movie is done.
One of the first things Patrick McHale and I would discuss is, I said, let's show what it feels to be a father when you're 70. It's already hard when you're in your 30s. Let's show what a workload that miracle of getting a second son really is. It's a handful.
I think it's interesting that innocence can be mistaken for rebellion. You know, it says something about the world we're in.
Truth is extremely uncomfortable, and people don't acknowledge that. When people talk about truth, which is a virtue, in many ways is the virtue,
yeah,
is very uncomfortable. And I think that was to be had, him asking, and Geppetto being unable to answer those questions.
Maybe you can tell me a little bit about authority figures in the film.
Well, you know, to repeat, father figures is a really good device. We use it, Kim Morgan and I use it on Nightmare Alley, because it's about possible futures. And one relationship illuminates the other. You have several father and son stories, including Jesus and his dad, and the fact that fascism is an authority figure based on a false fatherhood, and one illuminates the other. And nothing is casual in the laying of the story. Nothing is arbitrary, or, you know, there are two things, rhythm and what it means. And we have to pace the theme. One of the first passes was to lay obedience, for example. How many times do we have to test it, and how? Truth, fatherhood. Etc., etc. And that's why the song Ciao Papa resolves several of those stories. It's not just Geppetto and Pinocchio, it's also the recruiting of the kids to war. And that speaks to your point. The novel was written in 1881, very much like Frankenstein was in 1818, same numbers twisted. But it's because that's what was the now of Italy back then. What was needed, according to Collodi, was obedience. What is needed right now is the opposite. But you lay through this rhythm of echoing fathers and sons.
And each, I think it's interesting that each one of the fathers uses a different strategy to try and change Pinocchio. I think Geppetto uses guilt.
Why can't you be like Carlo?
Yeah, why can't you be like Carlo? And then, the Podesta is just intimidation. And then Volpe, he's trying to tempt him, like the devil. We haven't seen it's quite...
The riches of the world.
Yeah, he just sets him up and says, look at all this. This could all be yours,
It's... They will bow at your feet.
That's right.
My brand new feet.
Would you say that there is an anti-authoritarian message in the film? I
mean, 150%. Yes, I think that every single organized authoritarian thing in our world is corrupted. Everything.
Yeah, and Pinocchio says it right up front. It's one of the first things he says when he's alive is, but I don't want to obey.
Yes. And the cricket, I think that both the images that normally in Pinocchio tales show wisdom and kindness, show a little bit of pomposity and a little bit of ignorance, and they actually learn from Pinocchio, the cricket. Learns from Pinocchio, not the other way around. The cricket starts talking about how life is pain, and he has a Schopenhauer portrait on the wall and ends up saying, life is such a beautiful gift. And Geppetto starts talking about perfection with Carlo, how they should seek perfection and how he should never tell a lie. And he is accepting the lie of the system, and he ends up saying, I love you exactly for who you are. Those are big arches to do with the wisdom figures, and I think is, but the crushing the cricket curiously comes from Collodi. Collodi destroys the cricket, he crushes it, and that was good. The black rabbits of death come from Collodi, hanging Pinocchio, in the book, killing him comes from Collodi.
I wanted to ask some very specific questions about the look of the film and the development of the main characters.
Well, we had a sliding scale that goes from more realistic to cartoony, and you have to be careful how you dial it. And I think we spent a long time defining everything from how much the paint job on the hands or the skin was going to be realistic or not realistic. Everything is based on reality, real towns, etc., real carnivals.
But it all started with Pinocchio. He was the nexus of this whole thing. When Guillermo saw Grizz Grimley's original design, that was the spark that said, oh, this is, we can do this, because if you don't get Pinocchio right, then you can't get the movie right.
Yeah. But I think it's very carefully color-coded. We color-coded so that the goldens of the town sort of decay over time. You have the red that is used only for the possibility of physical death or the fascist camp, and the armband, and is in the uniforms, et cetera, et cetera. And blue is Carlo and the spiritual world, the book, his scarf, the balloon, the rabbits, the life-giving sprite and death. Even the fish is blue, because I think it's not a real fish. My theory is that it's a test, and is almost a metaphorical way to engulf Pinocchio and Geppetto into something common. And then after color coding, you have to shape code a little bit and make sure that the characters don't look too cartoony. When in the last minute deciding to make Volpe the only antagonist, as opposed to having the fox, the cat, and the puppet master, fusing it into one and allowing ourselves to give him the longest nose because he's a born liar, and not everything else has to fall in between Geppetto and Volpe. That's the cartoon. That's a And Mussolini and his henchmen are a little more like brutalist realism, so on. So it's, the design tells the story.
And you, Pinocchio is the anomaly. So the world, he has to stand out against the world. So he's different in a number of ways, one of which is just the technique we use to animate him with the replacement faces, where everybody else, for the most part, is just mechanical. So even if you don't register it really, you feel it, I think, when you're watching the film, and he feels alien.
How about the non-human characters, the ethereal blue spirits, the hideous dogfish? Can you elaborate about the relationship between the beautiful and the grotesque?
I find them beautiful no matter what. They're very related to Mexican lebrijes and Mexican carvings, and they're related to seraphims in the Bible, or Mesopotamian winged bulls in the case of death. And it is the Sphinx. Death is the Sphinx, which is always the one that poses the riddles. You know, so we just did a Sphinx like a chimera, and life is a lot more human-like. She stands up and gives life, but doesn't much think about the consequences. Death is more thoughtful, and the fish is based very much in the way dolphins were carved in ornaments in France. My mother had a piece of furniture, and it had a dolphin, and I was always very impressed with that. And I asked Guy Davis to take that type of dolphin, which is in the fountains of Paris and everywhere, and make it a big fish.
Please leave us with some words of wisdom for the young artists out there who want to break into a career in filmmaking.
Be fearless and and tell the story that you have. Don't tell somebody else's story.
Yeah, even in adapting something, what you do really, people call adapting, and people say it's a translation. It's not a translation. It's an interrogation of the material. You interrogate the material. You ask the questions nobody has asked of the material. That's how you approach adapting. And in that sense, what Mark says is, even in doing something based on somebody else's story, use your voice in telling it. And I think that's the only treasure you have. Nobody else has your voice. And you should believe that.